All right. Welcome, everybody, back from our lunch break. And it's my great pleasure to introduce the last, but certainly not the least, of our four artist conversations, this one with Marie Watt. Marie Watt is a member of the Seneca Nation of Indians and also has German Scot ancestry. She received an MFA in painting and printmaking from Yale University in 1996. She also has degrees from Willamette University and the Institute of American Indian Arts. Her interdisciplinary work draws from history, biography, Iroquois proto-feminism, and Indigenous teachings. In it, she explores the intersection of history, community, and storytelling. Through collaborative actions, she instigates multi-generational and cross-disciplinary conversations that might create a lens and conversation for understanding connectedness to place, to one another, and to the universe. Her work is in a variety of collections, including the Metropolitan, the Seattle Art Museum, the Whitney Museum of American Art, the Albright Knox Art Gallery, of course, Yale University Art Gallery, the Crystal Bridges Museum, the Smithsonian Institution's National Museum of the American Indian and Renwick Gallery, the Tacoma Art Museum, the Denver Art Museum, and the Portland Art Museum, among others. In On the Basis of Art, at the Art Gallery, she has one large two-part work from 2015 made of reclaimed wool blankets, embroidery floss and thread, and titled First Teachers Balance the Universe. And today, Marie will be in conversation with Anna Smist, who is a member of the Sac and Fox Nations, a nation of Oklahoma and Deer Clan. She graduated from Yale this past May as an English and History of Art double major, concentrating on contemporary Indigenous literatures and art. She wrote her senior thesis for the completion of the art history major, in part, on Marie Watt's First Teachers Balance the Universe, Part One, Predator, and Part Two, Prey, partner pieces. And it's because of that, I think in part, that Marie especially asked for Anna to be her interlocutor today. Anna admires the way Marie constantly gestures to Indigenous futures in her work, whether it is by making references to Star Wars, by including a stitched rendering of the Millennium Falcon spaceship in the Predator piece, or by other means. But I will now give give it over to them to speak to us about many things.
Hi, Marie. It's so good to see you.
Hi, Anna. It's nice to see you too.
Well, I know that, you know, we are tuning in virtually, so we're in very different places. But I would love for us to start this conversation there, maybe to consider whose ancestral lands we're on as well, and then also talk about the places that appear in your work, and going from, you know, IAIA in New Mexico to New Haven, Connecticut.
So. Sounds good. I'm speaking to you from my studio in Portland, Oregon, and I am in the traditional homelands of the Clackamas, Multnomah, Kalapuya, and Confederated Tribes of Chinook people. And it's an honor to be here today.
Thank you. I am speaking in New Haven, Connecticut, on the lands of the Mohegan, Mashantucket, Pequot, Scaticoke, Golden Hill, Pogoset, Niantic, and other Algonquian-speaking peoples. And it's an honor to be on this place that the Indigenous peoples have affected and continue to affect for its waterways. But in thinking about, you know, your work not only transcends these domestic borders that are in the present day United States, but you've also, you know, worked in different places with different communities. And I think that comes out in your work as well. So maybe could you speak to what it was like to be in New Mexico versus New Haven when you were a student?
Sure. I went from an undergraduate program to the Institute of American Indian Arts in Santa Fe, New Mexico. And I deliberately went to this art program in New Mexico because it fulfilled something that didn't exist for me in my undergrad experience, and that was being within an Indigenous community. And when I went to New Haven from New Mexico, I felt like there was a culture shock. And when I really tried to seek out an Indigenous community, I really felt like there wasn't one to be found. So one of the things that I am really drawn to in this moment, and what's kind of reconnected me with the community at Yale, is the Place Nations, Generations, and Beings exhibition that was initiated actually over a long period of time, but that culminated in a show at the Yale Art Gallery that you probably have a better sense of the dates of when it opened, and it lasted longer, I think maybe a little bit because of the pandemic, but it brought me back into the fold and really has been an important, I guess I would say it's almost been healing in some ways, because what I experienced as a grad student was more the feeling of isolation. And now I feel like there is a place for me in the community at Yale.
Yeah. Well, I'm so happy to hear that. But I also think the difference from when you were here in 1994 to now is there's a physical space on campus, the Native American Cultural Center, that was started in 2013. And so really, there just weren't any measures in place to support you at that time. And I think many of our Native alumni feel that way, and maybe especially Native women alumni, which I think is related to today's conversation. You know, thinking about 50 to 150 years of women at Yale, Native women are, you know, often maybe excluded from that conversation and not considered in the same way, because I think that experience of isolation is twofold. Like you said, you know, it's coming in maybe being one of the few Native people that you can tell in your program, in your major, and being surrounded by other Native women students at Yale was not always a given until really the 2010s, I would say. So in thinking about that, who were some important women for you during your time at Yale, whether that's through the art world at Yale or outside of it and after?
Well, I would say one instructor who was very influential and a person who I enjoyed engaging with was Frances Barth. And it's interesting, I should also mention that at that time, when I was a student, while there were women who were visiting artists and kind of the formal visiting artists, part of the formal program of but they were visiting artists and on faculty in that capacity, but there still hadn't been a female tenure professor in the art department at that time. So even that I think was pretty significant. And it might be that my tribe, I'm Seneca and a citizen of the Haudenosaunee and Seneca Nation, I've always been around strong women, and not to see any women in that tier within the program was kind of confounding to me. And so it made a difference to have people like Frances Barth, Romy Galan, also in the art history department, was a person who I was drawn to. And I'm searching now for, there was Rochelle Feinstein, and also actually Sylvia Plemick Mangold, who was really lovely. And I appreciated the presence of these women, but I also was just so aware of the absence of these voices in other contexts that were really important.
Yeah. And I think to go back really briefly to the Place Nations Generation Beings exhibition, like you said, you know, I think part of the student curators who are now no longer students at all, Joe is a current art history PhD student at Harvard, Leah is in Armenia, and Kay is currently here at the Yale Law School. Those students worked as interns in the museums here at Yale and realized that, you know, there was over 200 years worth of materials made by Indigenous artists, past and present, that were just sitting in the collections, but not necessarily being put on display in total, even though there was more than enough objects to facilitate, you know, plenty of exhibitions. And of course, your work was then acquired during that process, and I think pulled everything together, especially with you being an alumnus. And so, you know, thinking about that absence of voice and not only identifying it, but also trying to once again insert Indigenous voices back into the conversation, I think that exhibition did a lot of good work. And I believe it officially opened November 2019 and then officially closed last February, extended by the pandemic, of course. So did you have any moments during that process? I know you said it was a type of healing process for you to come back and be invited back in that way. But is there anything that sort of sticks out to you from that exhibition that you would want to share today?
You know, I think I have to go beyond the exhibition and really just touch on the entire experience of returning to Yale and seeing this like Indigenous community house where students can gather and be in community and support one another. I think that part of my experience as an Indigenous artist is I find the word art very limiting in its way of describing the multi-sensory, it's like the multi-sensory experience of what a piece of work is. And I actually think it is that gathering, and it's like, it's a tactile experience, and it's something that involves tastes and smells. And so connecting the people to the work in that exhibition and the entire experience of feeling that the campus was a place that I wanted to be at, like it felt like there were people like me there, and mm-hmm. that the work also, like, I think it's also really important for people to understand that the work in that exhibition drew different partners with from the campus together. And mm-hmm. I think the way the curators envisioned this show did something that is at the, that embodies what it Indigenous art often is, which it is, you know, multi-generational and cross-disciplinary and, you know, and even, you know, kind of intercultural or cross-cultural. And I think that the curators brought all these different entities together to create that show. And instead of having these kind of siloed spaces, they brought it to the Yale Art Gallery. And just the fact that honestly, that it was at the Yale Art Gallery, I think was very significant, right? Because this work, a lot of, or a handful of the work or a portion of the work had been over at the Anthropology Museum, right? So it had been completely in this different context that has all these other sort of associations that don't necessarily, for me, that don't necessarily honor the kind of living element that's a part of these objects.
Right.
It continues to be a part of these communities that are alive and amongst us, right?
Right. I think that's such an interesting point that you make too. And before we move on there, when I was a student worker for the gallery at that time, I remember the curators telling us that they had received some real pushback in terms of those objects, especially affiliated with the Peabody Museum, to sort of get them cleaned and a bit more prepared for presentation to be in the art gallery. And the reason was is that those curators at the Peabody were really unwilling to let, you know, any sort of material, dust, dirt that could be used for research and study away for the, you know, presentation part of it. And I think they had a good conversation there about, you know, this isn't just something that should be studied by a history PhD student at Yale. This is something that should be appreciated and really considered for what the maker was leaning towards. So I do think, you know, in this conversation about community, this panel is creating a community to talk about women at Yale, but also women artists at large. We would be remiss to not consider your own community practices in your work. Communities are so important in your work, especially through the sewing circles that you do through many of your projects, including the partner pieces that, you know, at first were in the Place Nations Generations exhibition, and now they are in this exhibition that's currently on display. So I'm wondering if you'd talk a little bit about that, you know, what does it mean? And pictured here, especially, what does it mean to have these other women at the table, these other people at the table working with you, constructing this work?
So, you know, the sewing circles started not knowing that it would exist beyond a kind of one particular project. But I think the thing that I've been, the thing that has kind of drawn me to continually doing them, and I've been practicing, I guess, or this has been a part of my practice for maybe 15 or 20 years now. And the thing that I am drawn to is I invite people to come and go as they want. I say no sewing experience is necessary. When possible, like this slide is actually from the very first sewing circle I ever had, and it's at our house kitchen table that was extended with sawhorses and doors. And I try to feed people because I knew everybody, you know, we all like food. And actually, it's funny, I do think that there's something that happens around a dinner table or a table with food, right? That is similar to what happens at the sewing circles. And that is that when your eyes are diverted and you're working with something as familiar as cloth, stories flow. And I couldn't say that this is a storytelling circle because people would never show up. But I think that there's something that when we touch cloth, it has so many kind of embodied memories. And I use blankets really because of what they represent in my family and in indigenous communities. And so that was a starting point, but I really quickly realized that, you know, these blankets, they're markers for memories and stories in all of our lives, really. And so the sewing circles for me are a way of, it's a way of bringing people together. It's a way of bringing people together in an era where our technology mediates so many of our relationships that I think we know our neighbors less. Maybe COVID has actually changed that a little, but it's a way to connect with people that we may not otherwise have the opportunity to meet. And so that's just, I guess, a little bit of context in regards to the sewing circles. And I will say one thing that is important, I guess, is that the sewing circles are really deliberately this event that brings people together, but it's not a sewing bee. And people should understand that sewing bees were used to actually colonize indigenous women and girls.
Yeah. Yeah, that's really important to mention. Well, thank you. Thank you for sharing this photo as well. I think that naturally leads me to wonder about storytelling, especially within the context of Sky Woman. And in my community, we would say that your actions are memory keeping. So you're one of the memory keepers for your community. So I'm wondering if you could tell us a little about Sky Woman, how she influences your work, especially today, and if we could just start there. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I've been thinking a lot, actually, with my earliest kind of blanket sculptures. I thought of them as being sort of ladder-like and connecting sky and ground, and connecting this space in which Sky Woman came to land on what we now call Turtle Island. And so the story, the origin story is, or the creation story is, that Sky Woman was pushed, or perhaps, or fell through this hole in the sky world where a tree, a very important tree, once stood. And as she falls, she is first assisted by birds who kind of help soften her landing, and then by animals. And Muskrat dives deep, 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 and pulls up this mud from the bottom of the ocean and puts it on the turtle's back. And then there is a dance that starts to happen, and this dirt starts to kind of create this space now on the back of Turtle that we now refer to as Turtle Island. And so that, I guess, in a lot of my work, while it's not always explicit, the formal vocabulary that I draw from really kind of harkens back or acknowledges these relationships.
Yeah. And yeah, your works really gesture at the sky in so many ways. They reach towards the sky, like these towering stacks of blankets here. And also in the pieces that we've been discussing that are in this exhibition, they're just surrounded by things that fly. And the blankets almost become this canvas of transportation, of things passing each other and flight, which I personally have always loved. I think every viewer, whoever comes across it, just gets lost in looking at all the things and imagining where people are going and what they're doing. So, you know, in thinking about Sky Woman and Turtle Island that we're currently on, do you think that there's a difference between Sky Woman and Turtle Island? Do you think that to know one, we have to know the other? And how do you think Sky Woman also would relate to our conversation today about women in places that maybe they haven't always been?
I think it's possible to know about Turtle Island or Sky Woman separately, but it's definitely the story builds, the story arc builds. And once you understand how interconnected they are, and of course, as a Haudenosaunee person, they're inseparable to me. But I think that Sky Woman and her role in our creation story really relates to the matrilineal customs that are part of being a Haudenosaunee woman. And that includes our clans are passed on through our mothers, tribal enrollment comes through our mothers, land ownership historically has always been the domain of women in our community and on the reservation. So I really connect those rights and responsibilities back to Sky Woman. And I think one thing that's important to know, though, is that, I mean, it's this story continues to unfold, right? So because of the way animals help Sky Women, we actually consider animals our first teachers, which really relates to the title of the piece, First Teachers Balance the Universe. And so first teachers are our animals. And by extension, first, I think that we're not just related to these animals, we're also intimately connected to the environment. And I collecting my thoughts.
No, thank you. Yeah.
Yeah. So they're intimately connected, and I'm circling back though to the question that you had asked about So ultimately, I think that Sky Woman is connected to this bigger picture, and that is part of that story.
No, thank you. I think what's so beautiful about the Sky Woman story is not only that it shows how women can go into places and truly, you know, make other worlds, make communities that we've been discussing this entire time, but it also shows that there has to be someone who was first, and that doesn't necessarily mean that she didn't receive help. As you said, she had help through her first teachers, the animals. And so, you know, when applying that to women at Yale, there were some first women that had to be on their own. I would say you're one of those first women for our Native community, especially, but you still had help along the way through the different professors that you had mentioned. And so, you know, in thinking back to all of this, I think we can learn from a lot of people. I'm learning from you as always today. And I think that, you know, it's really beautiful that that has come through in your work so clearly when you do reference back to Sky Woman.
Thank you.
But yeah, I don't know how much time I have before we fully go to the Q&A. Oh, okay. Maybe we have a few more questions that I can ask you. But I am really wondering as well about time. So we've talked about place, we've talked about community building, but I am also wondering about time in your work. And I think, you know, this is relevant because we're talking about why now? Why is this exhibition happening now? Why are we having this conversation about a woman artist today? But also, what does that mean for tomorrow? More importantly, maybe even. And I think that your work, it just absolutely encompasses everything around thinking about these questions of yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And this is a conversation we've had at another time, but I'm wondering if you'd be willing to get into it once again of, you know, including things like the Millennium Falcon from Star Wars in this work, right alongside bird tracks and, you know, helicopters, hot air balloons, all of these things, a part of each other. What does it mean to you to reference, you know, these sort of transportation devices? And I would even proffer to say that the blankets themselves would count as these transportation devices that, you know, I think you had said it once that we are swaddled in blankets when we enter this world, and then we might be covered in blankets when we leave it as well. So it crosses that temporal journey with us. So I know this is a very long and winding way of asking my question, but yeah, I am wondering what you think about time in your work, thinking about tomorrow and gesturing to the future.
It's interesting. You brought up this phrase that I've long been engaged with, and the phrase is transportation objects. And I first happened upon that term when I was a Smithsonian Artist Research Fellow. And at the National Museum of the American Indian, they categorized their cradle boards as transportation objects. And I started thinking about how blankets, they're transportation objects, right? And then I thought about that word and also how art is a transportation object. And we're talking about something that's physical and metaphysical. And so, and here we have it on screen right now. We have first teachers balance the universe. And I started thinking about things that fly. And in our tribe, we have 8 clans, and 4 are birds and 4 are animals. And, or sorry, 4 are birds and 4 are animals that walk the earth, 4-legged creatures. And I was really thinking about these animals and how our connectedness to them and this sky space that we share. And just for a little bit of background, in our community, traditionally you would marry the opposite, which would further create balance. So in some ways I realize, well, we have first teachers, balance the universe, things that fly, predator and prey, but in some ways I need to make the sequel to this piece that would be first teachers balance the universe, and it would be four-legged creatures that walk the earth. And so traditionally, though, we would marry each other to create this balance. And in this particular piece, I really focused on things that fly. My kids and husband are very engaged in different kind of sci-fi shows and the Marvel universe. And I'm a first, first generation person who watched Star Wars in the movie theater. And so all of these, there's these personal references embedded in this piece. And then there's also cultural ones. So I have the snipe and the hawk and the eagle and other, birds present. I also started thinking about things that fly from the standpoint of being a person who is the daughter of a Boeing engineer. And so for me, those wings, these panels are like wings, right? And they also make me think of airplanes, right? And birds. And this piece also had me really thinking about this sky space that we take breathing in air for granted, right? Our bodies are these kind of complex organisms that do this on our behalf, but we take breathing in this air outside for granted. And there's all these things that are happening in the sky space. And I think that we need to be mindful of how even that, what kind of extraction is happening in that space. And so this piece really kind of engages with a lot of different narratives. And I think that there's also familial connections and then site-specific references too. So this piece was stitched at two places, at the National Gallery of Canada in Ottawa and also in Sewing Circles, and then also in New Mexico in collaboration with Site Santa Fe. And so you can see there's like actual hot air balloons that are in this piece, as well as UFOs. There's early prototypes. They look like flying barbecues, early prototypes for the Amazon drone, for example, just to name a few of the references. I think the atom bomb makes an appearance as well. So that is a partial cast of characters that are present in that space.
Yeah. And I do apologize for the viewers who haven't seen these pieces before, since we have been talking around them quite a bit. But to see them and give you a sense, I mean, you can tell that these different panels. So what happens is that the panels are broken up and then divided amongst the sewing circle. And Marie will have a sort of pattern identified that she would like that person to stitch. And I remember one time you said that you actually love it when there's someone who's a first time stitcher, because they have so much personality to their stitches, and it really comes across. So many hands, you know, come across those panels, and then Marie puts them together and they all become a part of one. So, you know, here on this picture at the left, you can definitely tell that, you know, the magnitude of how many people are actually involved. And then I'll also say too, you can't really get a sense through the two D images, but there is so much movement to these pieces as well, and they are just massive. As soon as you walk into the room, I think they draw everyone's eyes and attention, and everyone walks over to them and is almost enfolded in the wings because they're so big. And as someone walks past, because they're blankets, they will sort of move ever slightly, because Marie stipulates that they should be free hanging, which I think is absolutely beautiful and means that you really get the sense that they are moving, they are flying, and, you know, they might be going outside of the actual space that is represented within the blankets themselves. So in thinking about this transportation, it really transcends even the skyscape depicted within the amount of space that Marie has allotted. So within that, I'm really interested about this sequel piece that you're talking about. I'd love to see it.
The foundation is being laid.
I love that. Well, so is there anything within your current work that you'd like to talk about? I know we haven't really talked about the Turtle Island pieces. We've talked a bit about Sky Woman. Another thing to mention too about Sky Woman, I think, is that you have this one piece that is Sky Woman beaded up. And then I believe it's Sky Scraper or Sky Walker beaded. Yeah. And they are sort of in conversation with each other because the blocks, if it's like a puzzle piece almost. If they were to be interlocked, they might fit in together. But you have them spaced apart so that they, you know, are near each other, but not exactly connected. So I'm wondering if you could speak a little bit about that.
Yeah, I mean, lately I have been using beads in my work, glass beads, and specifically these vintage Italian beads that were created in Venice prior to the 1920s, and a consortium of bead makers around that time disbanded and all these beads were put into storage. And then they recently, I think, must have gone to auction, and a bead seller, has this lot of these beads. And so when I first saw the beads, I connected with them instantly. There's some that are, that look familiar to me in the sense that I feel like I've seen them before in traditional Seneca and Haudenosaunee beaded objects. And so I was engaged in this idea of this material, like kind of connecting me through space and time to my ancestors, right? And so I've been working a lot with that material. And I have been interested in this. I'm interested in how beadwork has been kind of relegated to this like kind of traditional art category. Mm-hmm. When beads were introduced, you know, through trade and really like kind of used in maybe this like radically expressive ways, during this kind of early period in which Indigenous people were forced onto reservations, I think of them as these kind of radical, gorgeous expressions. And I find it, and it also actually is parallel to other like sort of art movements that are happening in Europe and elsewhere. And yet it's considered this kind of traditional craft in contrast to being this, you know, modern drawing or painting. And I guess that's one of the ways. So I've been using these beads on a really large form. There's Catherine and Lee. I just want to give a little shout out to, you know, some more women at Yale who really kind of, I feel like really brought me back into the fold at Yale. Anyway, so the pieces, the beaded pieces, first of all, they're on this large scale. They're like 4 by 4 feet. There's two pieces. They again kind of are like making this connection between the sky space and this ground space. I'm interested in the way that in our community, and especially actually within the Mohawk tribe, they are men and some women too, like are iron workers. And we've traditionally called our iron workers skywalkers. And I think that space is such like sky spaces are so compelling, right? Like they're these spaces that humans sort of seek to occupy, if not colonize, actually. Like, and it's a spiritual space. It's a mystic space, and so the piece sort of like the language, you know, prompts for me. It prompts a conversation about that space, and I also, again, like, I love that there's this double meaning for me as a person who did see the popular culture connection with Star Wars and a Skywalker. Like, when I was a kid, I thought it was so cool
that
I had Skywalkers in my community, and then here with like Luke Skywalker too.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think there's that kind of double layer or layers of meaning that kind of happen in that piece as well.
Yeah, so many different layers.
There's Moline, another person in the Yale art gallery that I want to acknowledge. She's the curator of programs and was really my main contact when I was invited to lecture and host a community sewing circle at Yale. And actually, one thing I want to say about some of these images that are coming up is that this piece that we were working on, I've been thinking a lot in my most recent kind of text-based piece. I've been thinking a lot about I have this question: what would the world be like if we considered ourselves companion species? And as I was thinking about that, I was thinking about our animal relationships and again, how we're connected to the environment. And then I was listening to Marvin Gaye's song, What's Going On? And the very first thing he calls out is mother, mother. And I'd been thinking a lot about the word mother and mother as like not just not a biological mother, although that's one type of mother, but like, how do we all carry qualities that are mother-like attributes? The more I listened to that song, the deeper I was listening, I started thinking, well, you know, the song would continue in it. There was this intersection between what I like to refer to as Marvin Gaye knowledge and Indigenous knowledge about our relatedness.
Yeah.
And so I've been thinking a lot about how like the song would continue to have this twinning of language in my mind, or my rewrite or addition of the song would include grandmother, grandmother, and auntie, and uncle, wow. And ancestor, and it would kind of go from there. And so at the sewing circle, we were stitching words that kind of relate to this conversation, and that was also kind of drawing from the poetry of Joy Harjo, and thinking about other relationships that we have. So like, I'm looking at the panel right now in front of us, and it's earth memory and old volcano and rains and guardian trees, and how it is that we are connected to these experiences and places in the world.
Yeah, I love that. It's such a device of connection and source of community that I love. I think too, I'll for sure read these two questions that are in the Q&A and we'll get to those. But I think going back one more time to the language around walkers, my family in the Sacan Fox, our last name is Walker. And I just learned in Thanksgiving that they actually shortened that. It used to be Big Walker. And in part, apparently that was the name that the Federal Bureau agent gave my family for making the walk from the Great Lakes area, where the Sac and Fox people, Sauk people, are traditionally from, to Oklahoma. So they gave my family, as one of the first families, Big Walker, which I kind of love. I mean, it does really make me think, and I think it covers the magnitude of what they did to get to Oklahoma and that story of removal. But just thinking about all these layered meanings that we've been getting at today, and, you know, using words like Turtle Island here in your work, I think it's so important, because language is so important. how great the shirt.
That was such a spontaneous and strange event when making this piece, or it was really just for a photo shoot with this incredible Indigenous photographer, just Jose Rivas. But one thing that I didn't anticipate was when I taped my body with the text and folded myself back into the piece, the degree to which I felt myself returning to a place. So it's one thing to talk about Turtle Island, but it's another thing to like put yourself in that word and in that place. And it actually made me think a lot of the artist Anna Mendieta and some of her performances, and the documentation is really beautiful, but then just like experiencing that actual way your skin touches, I'm thinking of Anna Mendieta's work now, but like your skin, her skin touching the ground and her bare body becoming one with that soil, that kind of life force, I think is really amazing.
Right. And there's some video clips of her as well when she, a part of her earthworks where she's underneath the soil, but she's still breathing. And so you see that movement. And I feel like that's an image that I think about sometimes when I'm just walking around, like, thinking about the earth breathing and movement. So one of the questions that has come up in the Q&A is, can you speak about your experience as a Smithsonian Research Fellow? What were the challenges you faced there as a Native woman? And were you able to remove barriers to further extend the Indigenous voice throughout the institution?
You know, I feel like that particular program was complicated for me. And I don't know that it was complicated because of the fellowship itself, or if it was complicated because I was a parent of, you know, two young children at the time. And it was hard to kind of make the space and time to parent. I think I even, for part of it, I brought my mom with me and she watched our daughters and I was able to do some research, but it feels like a project that in some ways, I don't know if the actual project I proposed was ever realized. In fact, I know it was not, but I think that having the access to the collections and the scholars that were available still really made a difference. I mean, I actually reference it quite frequently in my work. So if anything, I wish that there was maybe more time and fiscal resources, this also brings up an issue that I think a lot of artists face, which is how do we find spaces that support families and working artists? And I know that there's artists who, and myself included, that it's nice to sometimes perhaps have a break where your family isn't necessarily with you, so you can really dig in and get the work done. And I think sometimes that can happen, but other times it's just not realistic. And so what can that space be like? And I think for residency programs or fellowship programs to really support that kind of work, there needs to be something nimble, a philosophy of nimbleness, right? And which can just pivot to what the needs are, and that there's not a fixed budget, but there's resources that can be drawn in order to support that one particular or that particular situation. And I think that's like that's a complex ask, but I think it would be great if that existed for more artists. And I will say on that note, though, one thing that I really appreciate about being an Indigenous woman with so many great role models, and I want to just like give a shout out to my my mom, who's like probably one of my favorite mentors, and other Indigenous women in our family. But I think that like I've always grown up with women bringing kids with them and working, and the kids becoming kind of like folded into the community of art making and being together in community. And I think that that's really important. And I've never, I guess I oftentimes just feel like that's just an extension of the practice is bringing your kids with you.
Yeah. I think that is really true. I know that they used to talk, honestly, they've talked about pretty much every woman in my family is, oh, you know, that's Frances Walker with her 6 children in tow, you know, wherever she went. So I definitely think that's true. We have a way of sticking together wherever we are. The next question comes from Amanda. Thank you, Marie, for sharing your work and vision with us. I am curious how the politics of land and specifically landscape art factor into your art practice.
Well, when you say landscape art, my head kind of goes to the history, like, I don't know, Bierstadt and like the history of painting and physical landscapes. But then I also like to think of other painters, again, like Sylvia Plumick Mangold. I do think it's funny, landscape actually does feel like a part of my work, but not, but it's it exists in a much more abstract way. So, I mean, I think landscape can exist by saying a word like forest and pairing it with a word like rain or glaciers. On the other hand, I also have used army blankets in my work before, and I think of army blankets as these objects. It's actually probably my favorite blanket stories are just like these army blankets that my parents had from like a surplus supply store. And those army blankets used to go everywhere in our cars. And it was like the era of breezy station wagons. And we, like, you know, you would use the army blanket to like picnic and change a tire and build forts and stay warm after skiing. And, but in my work, like I think of army blankets also as these objects that are used to, you know, conceal a soldier in the landscape. And so for me, it actually is a metaphor for the landscape. And one of the things that I love about bringing a bunch of different army blankets together is that there's so many different greens and it makes that kind of landscape more complex. And so that is my relationship with landscape. And then there was one other part of the question. I think I forgot it though.
It looks like, yeah, just the politics of land and landscape art in your art practice.
Yeah, the politics of land I've been thinking a lot more about. And I think like in a way, like actually just using a phrase like Turtle Island is meant to engage in that conversation. Yeah. I am like in, I have this interest in that piece with my body in the within the word Turtle Island is really kind of this study for a neon sign. Mm-hmm. And I'm interested in what does it mean to have that word out in a public space? And what does it mean to invite, because of its public location, what does it mean to invite somebody to say that word? And if you don't, and I'm really drawn to the fact that I don't have to be the interpreter of that word, and that it is a word that just in its pairing, Turtle Island, I think is really poetic, and it too can be a transportation object. And my hope is that it's going to be a transportation object, and that it will put a viewer who says the word in the place of, in the position of learning more about what that word means and have agency to understand what the word means, but then also to like, what does it mean to actually think of North America, not as North America, but as Turtle Island? And how does that change our stewardship relationships with that place? And what does it mean? And I think actually the phrase should, or not the phrase, but like, I would like to see not just Turtle Island, but it's really Turtle Island and, right? Because Haudenosaunee used the word Turtle Island, but there's other indigenous names for these places. And we don't actually even have to go far to see them, because wherever we are, I want to invite everybody to just look around and like go out your front door, look at a map, and like you're going to see these names that are come from people who lived in this place. And I think in regards to land, like land is not something I would really like to see our conversations about land change. I think that land is not, traditionally, it's not something that was ever meant to be owned. I am a homeowner. I also, in a way then therefore own land. But I think that if we could start to refigure or rethink our relationship to place as temporary occupants, and also I think it does require us to think about what we are doing to the land, and we're all culpable, and we're all going to have to work to create change.
Yeah. Speaking of Moline, who is on this call, I remember one of those conversations that we had just about how many states in the U.S. territories are derived from Native names. Alaska, for instance, is from a first Alaskan name of Alakshyuk, meaning when the waves break their back. There's Oklahoma, the Dakotas, Minnesota, which comes from Minnesota of water. There's so many different names and places that we say constantly all the time and don't necessarily think about that intersection of language and place, even though I think you very rightfully ask us to consider that. And, I don't know if this is maybe where you would want to go, but I can see that conversation. What the way that I've seen the place conversation change in my time is definitely the use of land acknowledgements, but even moving beyond land acknowledgements and maybe saying, like, I am in the present day US. It hasn't always been called the US, even if it's labeled on a colonial map that you have seen. And maybe, someone saying, I'm from Turtle Island, which we could all say being in where we are. And also because Professor Fiducha is on this call, another shout out. I remember a conversation we had in one of our classes in our history about a warehouse, I believe, in Oregon that was repatriated to a local indigenous community. And thinking about land back in those real tangible ways of actual land and what that might mean. So it looks like there's one question, and I know we're one more question. I know we're nearing the end of our time. But Julie says, thank you for raising the practical challenges, realistic and conceptual, for parents who want and need to participate in residencies and research fellowships. And thank you for normalizing the discussion of these challenges and for bringing your children along. So that's actually not a question, that's just thanking you. But thank you, Julie. Yeah, are there any last notes that you'd like to end on? I will say I've really enjoyed this conversation with you, Marie.
I would just really like to extend my gratitude to Lisa Perodmirsky and Carol Armstrong and all the other women and humans who made this event possible. I am sad that it didn't happen more in person, because I would have enjoyed the new friendships that would be forged. But I know that there, like the, I don't know, there's threads that are weaving our stories together, and I'm just grateful to be here. There's a elder whose name now is escaping me, but he likes to say, my story changes when I know your story. And I think really that's what this conference is about. And that is, an important, and those, I guess the other thing is those stories like go way back in time to the women at Yale who preceded us, and to our ancestors, and those stories move forward in time too. And so it's been an honor being here, and I look forward to, continuing the conversation.
Yeah, having you back again one day.
All right. Thank you, Anna.
Thank you, Marie. And thank you, Carol. We'll pass it back to you all.
Thank you so much, both of you. This is beautiful.